Inside the Magic Show number 412 for February 24th, 2013. It is Sunday, February 24th, 2013. This is show 412 of Inside the Magic, and as always, I'm your host, Ricky Briganti. We've got plenty of Disney fun to bring you from theme parks and beyond, so let's jump into it in a minute. Before we get to that, I do invite you to visit our website over at InsideTheMagic.net. There you'll find all of our podcasts, videos, photos, news articles, and plenty more. And if you ever have any news, tips, questions, comments, anything else you ever want to send in, you can do so by emailing me at Ricky@InsideTheMagic.net, or you can call and leave a message at 407-494-4ITM. That's 4486. And now, let's get on with the show. This week's episode of Inside the Magic is brought to you by Magical Travel. Sail with the best cruise line for families. Kids sail free and shipboard credits offers for the Disney Cruise Line on select sailings are available. So let Magical Travel help you plan the perfect cruise vacation by calling them today at 866-207-8387 or visit them online at magicaltravel.com to receive a free price quote and be sure to mention Inside the Magic to receive your free Disney gift card for qualifying bookings when you book your Disney vacation with Magical Travel. And thanks very much to Jeff Beeman, Fen Zeng, and Jerry Avento for your donations this week, and of course all of our recurring monthly donation subscribers and anybody clicking through those affiliate links over on the website all supports the show very much, and I thank you for all of that. And now let's get started with the trip around the world. So today is Oscar Sunday, but I'm recording the show earlier in the day, so I don't know who the winners are yet. Disney isn't up for a whole lot of awards this year, though there are some really great films that are indeed and the contenders out there for Best Picture and you know, all the other categories. I did watch all of the Best Picture nominees. Lots of really, really good films in there. A couple I didn't like so much, but lots of good ones. Of course, Lincoln is the one that is most closely tied to Disney that is up for a lot of awards. Disney didn't actually make that film, but they are distributing it, so it's something. But really, in the world of animation is where Disney is having the most nominations, so we'll find out later tonight, and I'll certainly mention it on next week's show, who the winners are. My pick for animation, well, my personal favorite out of the nominated animated films is Frankenweenie, but I think Wreck-It Ralph will be the winner, and I certainly hope Paper Man will be the winner of the best short in animation, so we shall see. Of course, by the time you're tuning into this show, you probably already know the winner, but anyway, it's a little bit later today for me. So let's jump into theme park news now, where let's start with Limited Time Magic. Of course, this past week was Voices of Liberty doing some special performances at Disneyland and Epcot coming up. However, this coming week, February 25th through March 3rd, will be the one type of performance that Disney had been promoting for quite some time now. Since the beginning of sort of announcing Limited Time Magic, this was one of the performances that Disney had been saying, yes, this will be a part of it. Kind of give an example of what Limited Time Magic is, and that is the Dapper Dans singing boy band songs. If you've been over to the website, you may have already heard them or discovered what this will sound like. It is it's unique. I'm not a big fan of boy bands, certainly myself, NSYNC, Backstreet Boys, One Direction, New Kids on the Block. I don't know, the list goes on and on, I suppose. But not a personal fan of those. But when the Dapper Dans sing it, it is definitely more entertaining. So that'll be going on at the Magic Kingdom on a daily basis for those dates that I just mentioned, along with Disneyland out in California, of course. I do believe the Dapper Dans will continue to sing some sort of non-boy band songs as well, but definitely working the boy band routine in there as well. As I said, Disney did give a preview of this type of performance back in December. You know, of course, in December, all of the special, the media events were going on for New Fantasyland and Test Track, etc. But during a special presentation, sort of jointly combined with the opening of Splitsville, or the preview of Splitsville, I guess it was, in the movie theater at Downtown Disney out here at Walt Disney World. Disney did bring out the Dapper Dans as part of that and offered a bit of a preview of what that sounded like. So even though it hasn't happened as part of limited time magic just yet, I want to offer a little bit of what the Dapper Dans singing boy band songs is going to be like as they are doing it this week. So let's cue this up here and tune in for. Let's turn down the music and here are actually Meg Crofton gives a little bit of an introduction here, and then to follow that will be the Dapper Dans singing a little bit of the boy band songs.
So we are planning many surprises throughout the year to make memories that will last a lifetime. And we call it Limited Time Magic. It includes 52 weeks of magical experiences, big and small, for our guests. It's going to present classic Disney experiences in entirely new ways. To show you what we mean by that, we'd like to close with some special guests. The original boy band, please welcome the Dapper Dans.
Let me call you, sweetheart, I'm in love with you. Let me hear you whisper that you love me too. Keep the love light glowing in your eyes so true. Let me call you, sweetheart, I'm in love with you.
So there you have it. As a fan of Weird Al Yankovic's Poco remixes of pop songs, that certainly had a familiar kind of tone to me, and I really enjoyed that. I'm looking forward to seeing them on Main Street this week and seeing what other boy band songs they crank out. In my opinion, those are better versions than the original boy band songs. Of course, Dapper Dans billing themselves as the original boy band. So anyway, that's going on February 25th through December 3rd at Disneyland and the Magic Kingdom. Now, away from limited time magic, over to a first look that the Disney Parks blog offered this week of something that's going to be debuting pretty soon. Little bits and pieces of it have already rolled out over at Big Thunder Mountain out here at the Magic Kingdom at Walt Disney World. The new interactive queue is going to feature plenty of fun elements, even some explosions of sorts. Of course, the new backstory behind Big Thunder Mountain is going to be it's all surrounding this mining company that has to do with explosives and Yeah, there's even some crates that they've installed in there that say Western River Explosives, which is a great little tribute, a little nod to the old Western River Expedition ride that was never built from many years ago. You know, one of those concepts that probably should have been built along the way, but instead it never happened. But anyway, as you're walking through the interactive queue, you'll be able to do fun things like there will be plungers that you can press, you know, the kind that you would see in an old Looney Tunes cartoon that you push down and trigger some explosions on the mountain, some sort of puff of smoke or mist or water or something like that. You'll also be able to look through some various sort of little mirrored lenses type things and see the miners down in the mountain doing what they do. You go through the mining office and see the miners' schedules, and there will also be a ventilation room in which there will be a warning system for automated sort of warning system for gases that are building up in the mine, and I don't know, lots of things to play with, some interesting animations, etc., etc. Disney says that will all be officially debuting within the next few weeks. Seems like a good addition to what is normally a rather drab queue area. Speaking of waiting in lines, of course, recently I've mentioned that Disneyland was beginning to enforce the Fast Pass return times like Walt Disney World did so many months ago, and that has taken place now. You can no longer at Disneyland return after the window printed on your Fast Pass, and many have speculated that, like it was for Walt Disney World, that this is sort of an introduction to the beginning step for My Magic Plus or the Magic Bands or that whole, or even just Fast Pass Plus to make its way over to Disneyland, and it seems like that is the goal here. I don't have any sort of official confirmation on that, but it does look like most likely, as long as everything goes to plan probably out here at Walt Disney World, that chances are pretty good that Disneyland will be seeing the whole FastPass Plus thing sometime in the future. So, certainly rolling out at Walt Disney World first, and then we'll see what happens out on the other coast. Here's some yummy fun for both coasts, as well as several other locations around the United States. This week, Earl of Sandwich, the popular eatery out here in Walt Disney World, Downtown Disney, as well as most recently opened at Downtown Disney in Anaheim. That wonderful holiday sandwich is now a year-round offering. It has, it's been added already to the Anaheim menu. Beginning March 4th, it'll be added to all of the Earl of Sandwich stores, Disney World, and everywhere else on a permanent basis. So it's no longer really just a holiday sandwich. It's an everyday type of sandwich, and it is delicious, and cranberry and stuffing and gravy and turkey, and I could go for one of those right now. Very tempting to just head over there. Of course, it's not March 4th yet, so I'm not sure if we have them out here at Walt Disney World yet, but yeah, I will definitely be eating plenty of those throughout the year. Looking forward to that. And now in the world of video games, of course, Disney Infinity is the big talk from Disney Interactive, the big presentation that we brought you to a few weeks ago. Disney has now expanded on that with the next announced playset themed to Cars, and really to Cars 2 specifically. Disney Interactive showed off this week the playset will feature Lightning McQueen and Holly Shiftwell. Those will be the two figurines that come with it, along with a little clear piston cup that triggers that playset. And while you're playing around in the Cars universe, you'll be able to of course race around Radiator Springs, even develop your own races that, you know, you can create your own tracks and drive around them, etc. And then of course there's Toy Box mode, where you can pull in the Cars characters and have other characters ride on the Cars characters, which should be pretty fun. Other additional characters that you'll be able to buy, the figures of them will be Mater, as well as Francisco Bernoulli. Again, this is all kind of Cars 2. It's kind of odd that they decided to go with Cars 2 as the playset for this, and not just the original Cars, but maybe they thought the sort of spy theme and the characters from Cars 2 would be more fitting of this video game than the original. So, if you're a Cars fan, you can look forward to seeing those in Disney Infinity when it debuts in June. Also revealed this week in the world of toys, and we'll certainly be talking more about toys a bit later on this week's show, but from Diamond Select Toys, the first ever Disney Mini Mates will be coming out for Disney Store. Now, if you're not familiar with Mini Mates, I own several of these personally. They're these little figurines, kind of similar to Lego minifigs, but more articulated and has a bit of a different artistic style. They're pretty simple looking figures, but they're very, very popular. They span the worlds of, you know, there are lots of Marvel ones are out there. I personally own Back to the Future Mini Minimates and Ghostbusters Minimates and many, many others. Well, now the very first ever Disney Minimates will be from the world of Peter Pan. They're going to be coming out in early March, and there will be two box sets of four Minimates minifigures. One of them will have Peter Pan, of course, along with three of the Lost Boys, Cubby, Tootles, and Nibs, and also a miniature version of Tinkerbell that can kind of attach to Peter Pan's back. And then the other box set will have four more, which will be Michael, John, Captain Hook, and a full-size Tinkerbell. And then there will also be a little bit of a playset sort of thing, a pirate ship, which the Jolly Roger, Captain Hook ship, and that will have Wendy and Mr. Smee. And also in the world of toys for you Star Wars fans out there, coming out just in time for Star Wars weekends in May out here at Walt Disney World at Disney's Hollywood Studios will be two new Star Wars Star Tours action figure packs from Hasbro. One of them will be the Search for the Rebel Spy. Included in that one will be a Signal Droid, a Seeker Droid, and an Imperial Sky Trooper. And then the other pack that is coming out will have a G2 Droid, C-3PO, and an RX Droid. That's the Star Tours Sector 2 Security Pack. So you can look for those at Disney's Hollywood Studios first for Star Wars weekends, but then it'll be available at Walt Disney World and Disneyland as well shortly thereafter. Last little bit of news here is kind of a surprise, and we can, I don't know if rumor is the correct word to talk about this right now, but it is something that is definitely not definitely happening, but it's something that is in development from Gary K. Wolfe. You might recognize that name as being best known for writing the novel that inspired the movie Who Framed Roger Rabbit, one of my favorite movies. Gary Wolfe is now apparently developing a concept to bring Roger Rabbit back to the big screen in a new feature film called The Stooge alongside Mickey Mouse. This movie, if The Stooge rings any bells, there's actually a classic Dean Martin and Jerry Lewis movie of the exact same name, and you could almost call this a remake of sorts, but an animated version, rated G. He describes it as a Pixar-type animated musical buddy comedy. Apparently, it will incorporate various locations from Disneyland, as well as animated versions of Walt Disney and Orson Welles. Again, this is just in stages of development. It's something that Gary Wolfe is working on. That doesn't mean it's definitely going to happen. We'll have to pay close attention to that. It sounds like a great idea to me. I would love to see Roger Rabbit make it back to the big screen, and to have Mickey Mouse in a starring role would be wonderful as well. Of course, Who Framed Roger Rabbit, the original, is going to make its Blu-ray debut very, very soon on March 12th. And that'll do it for your news from around the world this week. And this week's tip comes in from Diane, who writes, if you want a bit of behind-the-scenes experience without having to pay extra, go to Rafiki's Planet Watch at Disney's Animal Kingdom first thing in the morning. That's when you're most likely to see the veterinary staff performing procedures. When I was there in December, I witnessed an annual exam on a pair of birds. A cast member on the public side of the glass relays questions to one of the cast members in the exam room, and it's a great way to learn more about medical care used on the animal. And as an added bonus, taking the first train to Rafiki's Planet Watch may let you see more animals in the barns as you pass some of them, as they may not have been given access to the Kilimanjaro Safari Savannas yet. It was a colder morning when I visited in December, and I was able to see the giraffes leaving their barns and headed out for the day. Diane, great tip. Going to the parks early in the morning, or sometimes even staying late at night, can result in some special extra magical moments like that that you might not be expecting, things that don't normally go on throughout the day because they're kind of early morning or late night things that happen. So definitely, I'm not exactly a morning riser. I try not to get up too early, but sometimes it is good, even if you're on vacation, to head out to the parks early to catch some of that extra special fun. Everybody else out there, email your tips into tips@insidethemagic.net. Now we've got some fun features planned for this week's show, but before we get to the first one, let me put in a quick word about Capturing Magic. It's a pair of iPhone apps that are the ultimate tool for documenting and recording the magic of your Disney vacation. Whether you're at Walt Disney World or Disneyland, Capturing Magic offers a helpful list of photo opportunities and memories to capture before, during, and after your trip, and it is the perfect way to ensure that you don't miss a magical moment. While you're in the parks, the app will remind you of the desired photo opportunity. opportunities on your list when you're near those locations. So then when you're when you take the photo, you can then use the app to mark off who is in the picture, what camera you took it on, and then later easily find and export and organize those pictures. And you can even email yourself a list of all the photos that you took during your trip. The Capturing Magic iPhone apps are available now in the iTunes App Store. Now we're going to take a turn away from Disney here for a moment for something exciting that I got to do this week over at SeaWorld Orlando. They offered a preview, a hard hat construction tour of Antarctica, the big new realm that they are building there. Empire of the Penguin is the name of the big attraction, the big ride that they are working on. Now, we didn't get to preview that so much yet. It is still behind closed doors. It is still under construction, but I did get to walk through Antarctica itself, saw some models as well of what the whole area will be like, and it's not huge, it's not ginormous, it's not to the scale of maybe most of Disney's, you know, major lands, as you will, but SeaWorld's calling it a realm, and it's definitely incredibly impressive for especially for that SeaWorld park. Definitely going to be the most immersive, sort of highly themed area at SeaWorld Orlando. Very enjoyable to walk through, even in its sort of dirty, you know, still under construction scaffolding phase, as I walked through this week. And it was also announced the opening date for Antarctica as well, and I had a chance to chat a bit with the creative director Brian Morrow, who you've heard from on this show before, talking about Antarctica and other topics as well. So instead of me blabbing on about it, let's actually bring you over to this hard hat construction tour. I'll let Brian take over for their special opening day announcement, and then also talk a bit more about what is going into Antarctica and a few of the decisions behind this new themed area and the Empire of the Penguin ride as well.
Okay, well, welcome everybody. My name is Brian here at SeaWorld Orlando, and today we have a sneak peek preview tour of our brand new construction site for SeaWorld Antarctica Empire of the Penguin. And today we have some big news for you. We are announcing the opening date of this epic attraction, the biggest expansion in our history. It will be Friday, May 24th, 2013. So be sure to be here for the opening of SeaWorld's Antarctica Empire of the Penguin. We are standing right in the center of Antarctica realm, if you will, in the center of the glacial rift. And directly behind me is the entrance to the attraction and pre-attraction and habitat spaces. So if you look at the rock work, you'll notice that the large rock resembles that of a mother penguin looking down, and the juvenile penguin is starting to take shape in that rock work and form a younger penguin nuzzling down underneath his mother. And that's an important story beat for us about the love, the connection, and the care that exists between families of penguins, individual penguins themselves, and in the community of penguins, and the story about how they're able to survive and thrive in the driest, the harshest, the most extreme environment on this planet. And our guests will have the same chance to experience those epic conditions inside of this world-class attraction, Antarctica Empire of the Penguin.
Can you talk at all about this area at night, sort of lighting package that you'll be installing?
It's relatively robust, and we've been doing lighting tests for about 2 years on the project, interior and exterior, not here in different areas and cities and warehouses. The replication of the ice was critical, mission critical to us as well. We wanted to have the ice at a proper scale, but we also wanted to not paint a bunch of rock work blue or white. The white you see here is our base color, and they're basing that out, and the plaster is white. But on top of this goes layers upon layers of different materials. Everything, I'm not gonna tell you what all the materials are because you'll get, it's not necessary, but most importantly was the integration of how to replicate the ice and how it glows in the Antarctica sun. And so we did that with a new system of acrylics and fiber, fiberglass materials that are being made in what we call the ice box. And there's gonna be a whole episode on the ice box, which is this warehouse that with the giant refrigerator that we build these things in up in downtown Orlando. But that allows us to really have elements and mixed materials that allows the sun to pass through during the day, but at night it allows lighting to pass through at night. And so we have a pretty robust show system as well that allows our audio control and our score that we created for this outside realm, and sound effects of storms to communicate with our lighting programming as well. So everything's really tied together, and so we create really beautiful environments at night as well.
An important element to all of your attractions at SeaWorld is, you know, it's the entertainment, but it's also the educational, the conservation, all of that message. How much of that is going to be in the sort of scene-by-scene part of Empire of the Penguin versus walking through, you know, sort of the two phases of the attraction?
Yeah, every attraction can't be like Turtle Trek. We can't sing it at the end with a giant score and big special effects. So they all have different goals and means to those goals. The story here, first, how the story unfolds in Antarctica is first we want to establish the place. So you walk through here and through the realm itself and through the glacial rift, which is what we call the space that we're in. And that glacial rift is huge and it's epic, and it's kind of nice because you'll walk through the front here. As a guest, this is not my favorite entrance, but it's the one we have to use. But it's a smaller ice, so everything you see is kind of considered small. And by the time you get around, we reveal Penguin Rock and the other ice, which is actually taller. You'll really get a sense for how large all this is, and we wanted that gravity, that mass and scale to be represented to scale. So Antarctica is amazing. This is amazing ice scape I'm seeing. But Antarctica can also be dangerous and wondrous, and that's a lot about what the ride's about. And the ride is really seeing Antarctica not as humans see Antarctica, but as Puck sees Antarctica. So there's some really wondrous moments there where we make that transition into really an imaginative world of Puck and how he sees his world, because he's a very special little creature and character. And then we return back and end up with the real colony of penguins there in Antarctica. So the story first is to establish the connection between our guests and the subject matter, the penguins and the space that we're at. As they're leaving, they will soon learn, and it actually happens in a bunch of different ways, and I can get to all of those today, but they actually learn that it's not really, what the unique thing is that we're all Antarcticans. If you remember the name tags we're wearing at the IAPA preview, that tells you that I'm an Antarctican, because I am an Antarctican by nature of living in North America and all the other countries that are part of the treaty that protects Antarctica. So that's why we should care first and foremost, because we already are, and we really want to position what guests can do to make a difference. And we'll actually not only tell them, we'll show them, and they will do it inside, not necessarily the ride, but the overall attraction, the realm itself, through a couple different ways of getting that done.
There it is, SeaWorld's Antarctica and Empire of the Penguin. It sounds like it's going to be a lot of fun. I was really happy to hear Brian's response about it not being so much like Turtle Trek. I'm not a big fan of the Turtle Trek attraction because it is very preachy, especially toward the end. As he mentioned, you've got the big symphony and the sort of moment of them, you know, praising themselves for all their conservation efforts, which is a wonderful thing, but you don't need to be beaten over the head with it. So it sounds like Empire of the Penguin is going to do a better job of sort of having a fun ride, and then after the ride, you can get all of the educational parts and the conservation and learning about the penguins and Antarctica and all of that. Very interesting there. Of course, May 24th is what he said, the opening date for all of Antarctica, the Empire of the Penguin ride, the restaurant that they haven't really talked too much about yet. It's going to be sort of a mess hall of scientists or something like that. I guess they said that, Antarctica, when scientists go and take an expedition to Antarctica, there's usually somebody in the group of scientists who thinks they know how to cook, or maybe they do know how to cook, and various cultures get together, et cetera, et cetera. So it's going to be sort of a combination of all of that, as if you're in sort of the human side of things, and that's the concept for that restaurant. It should be interesting. Hopefully the food is very good. Of course, there'll be a gift shop as well, and lots of ice to explore. I'm really looking forward to what he was talking about, sort of the nighttime light shows, and he mentioned even something about storms rolling through and the lighting interacting and the music and the, you know, score and all of that. Sounds like it's going to be just a nice area to relax in. And of course, Empire of the Penguin is going to be a very cold attraction as well. Now, previously, SeaWorld had mentioned many times that it's going to be like the coldest attraction on Earth. Well, they're backtracking a little bit from that now, and they're just saying it's going to be the coldest attraction at SeaWorld. So we'll see how that goes. Of course, Universal Orlando, meanwhile, is still building Transformers and hasn't announced an opening date for that. They opened Transformers in California on Memorial Day weekend, which is now when Antarctica is opening this year. So we'll see if Transformers also opens that same weekend to fuel some competition there or what happens. But regardless, I'm excited for it all. Can't wait to walk through Antarctica again when it's all done. Head on over to InsideTheMagic.net to see lots of photos and more video from this hard hat construction tour of Antarctica at SeaWorld Orlando. And now we do have another main feature coming up, but before we get to that, Let me put in a quick word about Lanyard Lab. This is the place you want to go if you need some custom lanyards to wear around your neck, whether you're at a convention or a school or business or really any organization where you need a name tag or an ID card or even for promotional use. Head over to lanyardlab.com, click where it says get a quote, and from there you can fill out our get a quote form, quote request form that'll allow you to submit all your details to us, put your text, your logos, your colors, whatever you want on the lanyards, pick your type of material and attachments. Once you submit all that to us, we'll email you back with a price quote for your design, along with the proof showing you what it'll look like. There's no obligation to purchase from there. It's all free to preview. So check it out over at lanyardlab.com. That's LanyardLab.com. Now, last week on the show, I was talking about the Monsters University event that Disney Consumer Products put on at Toy Fair in New York, and Toy Fair was so much more than just that one event. That one event certainly was a highlight, if not the highlight of the event, certainly the Disney highlight, but there was a lot more to be found. I scoured the hundreds and hundreds of booths and exhibits throughout the four-day industry-only event at the Javits Center right there in New York City, just a few blocks away from Times Square, and the result of that was seeing plenty of exciting new Disney products that'll be coming out over the course of this year, throughout 2013. Some of them are already on store shelves. Many of them were previews. Many of them were top secret, and I couldn't even talk about those, but the ones that I could share, I have already posted a huge Disney wrap-up over on InsideTheMagic.net, where you'll find lots of photos, hundreds of photos of Disney products, and I've got another wrap-up coming up this week of all the non-Disney products as well, hundreds more photos as well. But here on the show, I wanted to take a closer look at some of the Disney products from some of the big names, starting with Mattel. Now, in a special Mattel showcase, they actually took over the fourth floor of the Javits Center. They had this private area, all to themselves, an invitation-only showroom that I get to go. I got to walk around and see all the products that were coming out, not only from Disney, but also the ones related to like Monster High, big property there. Saw some new Ghostbusters stuff, He-Man, et cetera, et cetera, you know, with the Maddie collector line and all of that. As I said, non-Disney products you'll be able to see very soon over at InsideTheMagic.net. But focusing on Disney here and now, got a very thorough demonstration of Mattel's upcoming Disney products that are, as I said, rolling out throughout this year. So now I want to take you over to the big Toy Fair event at New York City for a demonstration and a walkthrough of the exciting new products coming out from Mattel.
Welcome to the wonderful world of Disney. We're a best-in-class leader bringing entertainment properties to life, and we're really excited to be teaming up with them and Disney Pixar to bring all of our favorite on-screen characters to the playroom. So we know that even the littlest girls love Disney princesses, and we brought the magic to the little people. So this is our clip-clop stable, because even a Disney princess's horse needs a nice place to stay, of course. So here we have several levels, beautifully decorated, just perfect for a Disney princess horse. So we can start up here with Rapunzel and Maximus taking in all the beautiful views of the palace, of the castle, I'm sorry, and then they can clip-clop on down to the second level. You can hear where it gets its name because it actually makes a clip-clop sound. She can grab a quick bite to eat. From there, she heads on over to the second level, into the tower. So she can maybe grab a book, have some tea inside. And it's one final stretch on down to the ground floor where she can go and say hi to her friend Aurora and Samson, who are also included in the set. Now, we know that princesses love dancing, but their horses also love to dance too, which is why they can go inside to the courtyard and spin around to music. And when they're ready to hit the hay and head on home, they can gallop off into the sunset. It activates another sound cue there again. So. Very cute. But we know that all the little girls would want to expand their clip-clopping adventure, which is why we have a clip-clop doll assortment. We have a Belle, a Cinderella, and an Ariel, each coming with their own track piece as well as play food so they can take their adventures anywhere. And while little princesses are playing while little girls are playing with their princesses, we know that boys will want to be boys and play with the pirates, right?
Of course.
So, which is why by Jake and the Neverland Pirates is one of the most popular preschool TV shows out there. The product line is performing very, very well, and we're excited in 2013 to be bringing to life the most iconic location in the TV show, which is, of course, its hideout. Did you want to see a sizzle of that?
We're going to play with the toy a little bit.
Okay, great. So it's Magical Tiki Hideout, which is very exciting. So the Magical Tiki actually activates all of the hidden surprises and features throughout the hideout. So we'll start out here in the front, and voila, it pulls the palm trees open, revealing a secret entrance, as well as dropping two doors on the second level down to reveal a real working peggable cannon, as well as a spyglass so you can keep an eye out for Jolly Roger and Captain Hook. And as we head on inside, Jake decides he needs a better view, so he goes up on his crow's nest, and as soon as he gets up there, he's spotted Captain Hook, and he's on his way, so he's got to race right back down, head down to the ground level, and activate Hook's nemesis, TikTok Croc, to go chomping around and swimming away. And for our last final getaway, he can slide down the slide, leaving Hook in the dust.
There's kind of a built-in story to go with it.
Exactly.
And for those two products you just showed, what is the age aiming that you're aiming for?
This is preschool, or I guess very, very young, 2, 3.
Okay.
This is a little bit older, so maybe like 4 or 5, somewhere around there.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
Looks like we're moving on to the Mickey Mouse Clubhouse now.
Yes, so again, we're bringing to life another iconic location from his TV show, which is, of course, his clubhouse. This is the Fly and Slide Clubhouse. And as we head inside, we can see Minnie gliding around on her airplane while Mickey's ready for some silly fun. We can press down on the purple lever, watch as he disappears through a trapdoor and slides down the green slide. Minnie's plane is also detachable, so you can take her as high as your heart desires. And when these two are ready to relax, they can hang out on the seesaw here, grab a quick bite, or even head on inside to the living room and snuggle up with a nice book. Now moving into Minnie. Minnie is on fire, and we're really excited to be expanding her very popular fashion doll line, as well as bringing some new news to the Minnie line, which is her feature doll, which is very exciting. It's a first for Minnie. It's never been done before. So first up, we are in the fashion doll category. This is our Pampering Pet Salon. It's actually going to be featured in our big, huge movie event coming out this fall. So it looks just like it does in the movie. Girls can start out by having their pet go through the pet wash, and as we turn it with the bow, we'll get some fun cleaning sounds.
Now we're ready for style.
Just like Minnie said, we're ready for some style, so we can sit her on down in the salon chair. She can get her fur fluffed to perfection, and then maybe right after that, she can get a nice, adorable bow. Now Minnie decides she wants in on the action, and she decides she wants to wear a bow, maybe touch up her makeup in the large vanity, and with the push of a button, we get some more fun phrases. And even some original songs in there as well. When she's ready to try on a new outfit, she can head on over to her closet. What's great about these fashions is that they clip on very easily, so a girl can do it all by themselves. And for one last final reveal, we have a little secret surprise. Our puppy dog's waiting in the wings for his debut. And then activate some more sounds. Very cute.
And it looks like we have a much larger mini cheerleader type doll.
Yes, she is our feature doll. She's our breakout star this year. We're so excited about her. This is Three Cheers Mini, and she's ready to cheer on her favorite boy, or should I say mouse, and her adorable cheerleading outfit as well as pom-poms. So she likes to cheer. She's got some fun phrases and, of course, her iconic song to Mickey.
Pom-poms in the air, let's cheer. Oh, Mickey, you're so fine. You blow my mind. Hey, Mickey.
So speaking of breakout stars, Mattel is very excited to be introducing Disney's newest princess, which is Sophia the First. She has her own series on Disney Junior, and when it premiered, it garnered the number one preschool series launch in cable TV history, so it's huge. So we're excited to be bringing her magical world to life this summer, this June, actually. We'll have three different segments, each of them focusing on a certain part of her story. So first up, we have our core segment. It's our 3-inch dolls here. It's all about storytelling. And of course, a princess needs a castle to call home. So this is Sophia's magical talking castle with so many different areas and places to play and fun features and surprises. It's a perfect place for her to call home. But probably one of the coolest things is the interactivity here. Whenever a girl places either Clover the Rabbit or Sophia on the magical pedestal, it'll actually unlock a character phrase.
I'm ready to play all day.
Which is very cool. So it actually recognizes whichever character is on top and will unlock more phrases. So you can bring any of the other princesses into the castle and unlock even more of them. Now moving into our 10-inch segment for Sophia. In this segment, it's all about friendship play and nurturing play, which we know our core girl loves. And we're also really excited with this doll to be bringing to life a very unique attribute or trait of Sophia, which is her ability to speak to animals, which is very cool. I mean, I can't speak to animals, so I'm envious. She uses her beautiful amulet there, given to her by the king. She'll actually recognize and speak to either Clover the Rabbit, we have Robin the Robin, as well as Mia the Songbird. She's got some fun phrases of her own, so we can hear that. And then when one of the characters flies in front, she recognizes her, speaks to her, and then gets her own unique response in return. So with so many different characters and so many different phrases, it's hours and hours of interactivity, which is great.
Sophia is, seems like it's Disney's youngest princess, I guess they have said, and you said the show has been very popular since it debuted.
Yeah.
Are you in the works with even more Sophia products for the future?
Absolutely.
This is sort of the first run of them.
These are the key TV drivers for this year, but we've got a full line coming out. So yeah, tons and tons of toys that they can play with.
Okay, great. What is the age range, just to run through sort of those last few that we did?
So, again, this is preschool, younger girls, same with the minis as well. So.
Okay, great. Yeah. So moving on to something much larger.
Yes. So, of course, we know that our youngest girls love Disney princesses, and they're going to take that love with them as they grow up, and we want to be there while they're growing up, which is why we have the huge, ginormous Ultimate Dream Castle from Disney Princess line. As you can see, gorgeous, three levels. Each room is beautifully decorated, perfect for each princess. We have Snow White here in the kitchen, Belle in the dining room with her guests. We have Cinderella in the sewing room sewing some beautiful designs, as well as Ariel in the bathroom so she can lounge. And we also have Sleeping Beauty's vanity there so she can get royal ready in the morning. And the newest addition, of course, is Rapunzel. She's got her third floor bedroom here, complete with a spiral elevator so her and her princess friends can go all the way up and down. And featured with our castle is also, obviously, as you can see, our Disney Princess Sparkle dolls. So all the girls' favorite princesses are back in beautiful, dazzling, sparkling attire. So we have some satiny skirts, glittery bodices, sparkly tiaras, so they can surely have a sparkle ever after. But probably the coolest thing that's coming out for 2013 is that we're bringing both of these products to life in a new interactive way. We actually have our own exclusive app. It's called the Magic Mirror app. It's on the iPad. And this is how it works. So throughout the castle, there'll be several triggers that the app will recognize, and it'll either start an augmented reality or a mini game. So we'll start out in the front here, focusing on that clock up top. As soon as it recognizes it, I can send some fireworks going. Now, since it is augmented reality, no matter where we turn, no matter how we look, we'll still see the fireworks, which is very cool. Another trigger will also be the front door. We'll activate Jasmine flying out on her magic carpet. And then on the inside, each of the rooms will actually have a mini game. So I'm just focusing on Flounder here one moment. As soon as it recognizes it, it starts a mini game with Flounder. This is a bubble popping game, so very easy, very fun, very addictive, honestly. So pop the good ones, avoid the bad ones. Another game will be in the kitchen. You can actually virtually make your own pie with Snow White. You can sew some dresses with Cinderella. You can paint with Rapunzel. So tons of interactive play here and integrating a totally new way to play with them.
So you buy the castle, the app is included with that, or is that an add-on?
So the app is going to be available August 1st. It can stand alone, but of course it's going to be at its most fun with the castle. When you do buy the castle, you get a code, so you can actually redeem it in the Apple App Store,
right.
Apple App Store, something like that.
Yeah, the iTunes Store.
There
and,
you go.
And so Rapunzel is over here twirling on her hair. When the other princesses are on there, they are also using Rapunzel's hair, I assume?
Yes, she's very generous with her hair. She'll let anyone use it.
And recently Disney sort of gave a little bit of a redesign to the princesses, little new hairdos and dresses. Is this sort of in the line with the new princesses?
Exactly, yep. Just like you said, we're basically just refreshing their look a little bit here with the glittery bodices and such. So.
Okay, great. Moving on from princesses, finally, something for maybe the little older generation of boys here and upcoming sort of, this is a spin-off of Cars, right?
We'll start off with Cars, yep, right over here, actually.
Oh, we have Cars as well. Okay, excellent.
Yeah. Disney Pixar Cars, everyone loves it. It's an evergreen franchise that's been supported by 2 feature films, tons of Disney tunes, and let's be honest, some pretty awesome toys. So since the first launch of the first movie in 2006, we've actually sold over 256 million die-cast character cars worldwide, which is amazing. Yeah, it's great. And for 2013, we're really excited about some more cars. Kids, Cars fans can actually expand their collection with an extended line of our microdrifters, or they can have even some more fun with those microdrifters at our microdrifter fast flip technology raceway, which is really exciting. So the microdrifters, wait, I'm ruining the surprise. Don't look. I gotta reset.
Look away.
Okay. So, microdrifters takes that world of cars and shrinks it down to a super fun micro size, but with a twist. Thanks to a small ball bearing on the bottom of each vehicle, you can actually recreate all your favorite swarming and drifting moments from the movie. And of course, we've got a vast crew of characters, everyone from the Radiator Springs, we've got our Boom Racers and our Tuners as well. Now, they look great swarming and drifting, but they look even better when they're racing towards the finish line, which is why we're really excited about our microdrifters fast flip raceway. So just like in the movie, kids can recreate Lightning McQueen's story journey as he trains at Willy's Butte to get to the Piston Cup race. So here we have Willy's Butte. As he's racing around, he'll either take 2 paths. He'll go back through the booster again and train some more, or he'll activate the fast flip technology. And how they're getting around is actually this kid-powered booster here. You pump it and it swirls around there and it catches them and shoots them through. So we'll see if we can activate the raceway and see if we can get to him to be a winner. And there it goes. And of course, you race to the finish line and you have a winner in the end. So that's our Cars. And high above the world of Cars is Planes. Like you mentioned, it is the newest Disney animated film coming out this year. I have a trailer for it. Would you like to see that or no?
Seen that online many times.
Awesome, okay. So you know all about it.
Yes.
So we're really excited about the whole world of it. We want to bring it to life in totally new ways. Again, we're going to be working with Diecast to create some great vehicles. They really are great at bringing those characters to life and all the details and such. Now, he looks great just sitting around, but he looks the best when he's flying through the air. So, we have the Sky Challenge track here, where kids can recreate their favorite racing moments from the movie. So we set him up here. He's going to take some impressive speeds, some barrel rolls, and get down to the winner's circle, activating a checkered flag, and can even meet his friend down there, his mentor, the naval aviator.
So I see there's 2 tracks here. Are you supposed to put them head-to-head, side-by-side, and whoever's the winner gets the flag?
Exactly. So every time you get through it, just like that, it either goes to one side or the other.
And these are characters from the film?
From the film, yep. We'll have all the characters from the film.
Okay, great.
And since we know that Dusty is going to be every kid's new best friend, we wanted to give him more ways to play. So this is the wing-controlled Dusty. Now, he is a radio-controlled vehicle, but unlike others that just have a boring old traditional controller, we actually gave the kids the controllers in their hands because the wings are actually the controllers. So I'll turn him on here. So you actually get some sounds. He talks to you, introduces himself a little bit.
My name.
So, give him a little quick propeller twirl there, and when I turn left, he'll turn left. When I turn right, he turns right. So a lot of interactive activity there as well. That's Dusty.
So what is the availability of all these products? Are they going to be rolling out throughout 2013?
Yep, they're all going to be rolling out throughout 2013. We're really excited about it.
Excellent. And just major retailers everywhere?
Yep, exactly.
Fantastic. Thanks for taking the time.
Yeah.
definitely a lot of fun stuff in that group. You know, I'm not sure if Planes is going to be a great spinoff of Cars. I'm a little undecided on that. Not a lot of information about there is known, really, other than the one trailer they've been showing over and over. But the products look like a lot of fun. That demonstration of the zippy plane thing there at the end looks like a lot of fun. And being able to sort of flap your wings left and right to make the plane character move as well, a lot of fun there. The new Princess Castle is coming out from Mattel. Very impressive with the interactive features on an iPad. You hold it up and you see the different things showing up, sort of augmented reality, if you will. Really fun additional feature. You can get the app separately, but really getting the whole castle together is even better. So some fun products coming out there from Mattel. Shifting gears completely, still a Toy Fair, of course, to a totally different product line. Square Enix, a company that you might be most familiar with for Kingdom Hearts, a great sort of Disney crossover Final Fantasy video game series that's been very, very popular going back many years now. It is still in the works. You know, there are still more video games for 3DS, etc., more on the way, and Square Enix is coming out with some really excellent new Kingdom Hearts figures that I will definitely have to purchase. And got a tour of their little booth, as well as talking about a few of their other sort of non-Disney products that they really wanted to show off. So let's hop over to their booth at Toy Fair to find out more about their Kingdom Hearts products and a few more. We are at Toy Fair 2013 in New York, and I'm standing here at the Square Enix booth. Why don't you introduce yourself, and we'll talk a little bit about Kingdom Hearts here.
My pleasure. My name is Kelsey Britt, and I'm Merchandise Coordinator for Square Enix Products. And so I'm really excited to show you guys all of our exciting new Kingdom Hearts products that we have on display here at Toy Fair.
Excellent. Kingdom Hearts series has been around for quite a while now. It was a big hit, certainly as soon as it came out of hit the shelves. And here we are many games later, and we've got some pretty exciting things to look at here. So why don't you walk us through what merchandise you have available?
Yeah, of course. Kingdom Hearts actually celebrated its 10th anniversary last year. So as a huge fan of the series myself, I'm really excited to show you guys some of the figures that we have from our latest entry into the franchise, which is Kingdom Hearts 3D Dream Drop Distance. So the first to come out from this lineup is going to be Sora and Riku in their Tron Legacy versions. So that means they're going to be all neat and blue and black, and not in the way that people usually say black and blue. So almost like a glowing effect on the paint job here. We tried really hard to recapture that really cool and unique way that they look in the Tron worlds. And this is actually the first time we're getting to see Riku in sort of that Tron Legacy style. So if you're a fan of Tron, Kingdom Hearts, Riku especially, this is an excellent opportunity for merchandise.
Definitely. I mean, Tron certainly very big in the world of Disney. It was a Disney film, obviously. There was the animated series recently, and now you can jump into the world of Kingdom Hearts with it. This was part of the game that this is representing.
Part of 3D Dream Drop Distance is you return to the world of Tron as it is portrayed in Tron Legacy and have to sort of save your old friends that you remember from Kingdom Hearts 2 when you first entered the world of Tron.
Excellent. So what are these little tiny figurines that we have?
Okay, so these are our Formation Arts. So this is the Disney characters Formation Arts from Kingdom Hearts 2. It's actually the third volume that we have of these. They're just mini statues that come on a stand, that kind of like a chess piece. And they're collectibles. In Japan, they're sold as blind boxes, but in America, you can buy the whole set of four for a single price. That's to be determined. We're not sure how much it's going to be, but typically they run around, like, I want to say anywhere from $25 to $40, just depending on the size. So what's really great is that we are finally kind of getting a peek into some of the worlds as they're displayed in Kingdom Hearts, as opposed to before we had characters. Right. So previous Formation Arts from Kingdom Hearts had Axel, Roxas, and some of those other like character-based ones. This one is world-based, so this time around we're seeing Little Mermaid as it appeared in Kingdom Hearts 2, Halloween Town, which is a personal favorite, Destiny Islands, where our adventure begins, and Tron, as previously mentioned. This is the first time that Sora traveled to Tron's world.
And you said that those, you have to actually put them together when you get them?
They should come all as one piece. Yeah.
I've seen similar sculptures that you know come from Japan, and they have all these little tiny parts you have to squeeze together, but this one's all one unit.
One unit. So what happens is in Japan these are released as blind boxes, and there's one more figure available, but you never know which figure you're gonna get. So that's the bugbear of it.
Right.
And what's great about what we release in America is American consumers tend to want to like see what they're getting, so you get the whole set of four at once instead of having to buy tons and tons of boxes and trying to trade with your friends. The downside is that you do miss one, so there's one like mysterious Japan exclusive that you're gonna have to work really hard to get your hands on.
Okay, yeah, that's what eBay's for, right?
Exactly.
All right, and finally, we have some pretty impressive larger figures here. What can you tell me about those?
So these are also articulated action figures like the Tron Legacy Sora and Riku, but this is just how they normally appear in their standard forms in Kingdom Hearts 3D Dream Drop Distance. So Sora's costume is pretty much the same as it is in Kingdom Hearts 2, but with like minute differences. These also come with the same three different Keyblades, so it's a great value. The price point is yet to be determined, but for the previous figures it was $69.99. But it's a fully articulated, beautifully detailed, painted action figure, and need I mention, three full Keyblades. So we also, for the first time, are seeing Riku as he appears in Dream Drop Distance. So he also comes with three separate Keyblades, including one of his signature Keyblades. And he comes with exchangeable hands, as does Sora. And you really can like have some fun with posing these guys. If you decide to get both, then it'll be really fun to see them in battle together or battling each other, as they tend to do. So that's all I have for today from Kingdom Hearts and from Disney. But we're really excited, and there's always a possibility that we'll have more and more to come.
Excellent. So looking a little bit outside of Kingdom Hearts as well, what other well-known franchises are part of Square Enix?
We do have something really excited that we are just unveiling here at Toy Fair, so if I can show you.
Oh, definitely.
So we've had a pretty successful run with Batman Arkham City and Arkham Asylum, and now we're expanding into the film universe. We've shown these before, and actually they're coming out a little bit later on this year. In March, Batman and Bane from the Dark Knight trilogy, Dark Knight Rises. And then later on in June, Catwoman, as she appears in Dark Knight Rises, and Joker, as portrayed by Heath Ledger.
Those are some very, very detailed figures.
But even more exciting, and what we're showing for the first time ever, is our DC Universe variants. So this is Square Enix's reimagining of the mythical figures from the DC Universe, like Batman, Wonder Woman, Green Lantern, and there are even more to come. So our first wave is, we're hoping to get out this summer, but you know, things change. This is sort of like the most exciting thing that we've done, the sort of most creative and out there thing that we've done. And it's a little bit risky, but I think that people are going to really respond to this really cool fantasy, Final Fantasy-esque reimagining of the DC characters. And then after this wave of the first three characters is going to be Flash and Batgirl. So that's sort of the thing that we're most jazzed about at this New York Toy Fair. We really hope that people are going to respond as strongly as we feel passionate about this project.
Excellent. So all of these products that we've been looking over are going to be coming out over the course of this year?
Yeah, that's the aim. I think there are only a couple, maybe Flash and Batgirl will be coming out late this year, early next year. But everything is probably going to be able to get, you're probably going to be able to get your hands on it within this year.
Does Square Enix have an online store, or is it better to get it through other retailers?
Square Enix does have an online store, but unfortunately it's been down and we're working on getting it back up. So you can visit us at square-enix-shop.com just to get an idea of what the newest items are that are available for a purchase. But we also work with retailers. AAA Anime has an online presence. Diamond Comics Distribution is our main distributor, and then Bluefin we also work with, and Entertainment Earth also has an online warehouse that you have access to.
So those are good places to go if you want to find out more information and get any of these when they come out.
Exactly. And always go the straight and narrow route. It's easier and it's faster, and you can definitely have us respond to you if you have any problems at all with your figure. We're happy to respond directly and help you get a replacement or a repair.
I'm definitely going to have to get those Tron, Sora, and Riku figures for Kingdom Hearts, and maybe even the little Play Arts figure as well, the set of four that we were talking about there. Definitely some nice products. A little pricey. I think it's, I don't know, $40, $50, $60, something like that for the bigger figures, but they're very highly articulated. As she made a point to mention several times that they come with a number of Keyblades, and they are just the detailing on them is phenomenal, and I don't really own a lot of Kingdom Hearts stuff, so I think that'll be a good addition to my my vast collection of toys. Let's do one more visit to another major toy manufacturer with a lot of Disney licenses as well. This time stepping away from sort of the traditional Disney and moving into the world of Star Wars. Of course, Disney now owns Lucasfilm, and when you think Star Wars toys, of course you think Hasbro. They've had the license for Star Wars for many, many years now. Of course, they inherited it from purchasing Kenner years ago, and it's been Hasbro ever since, and they have a lot of really fun new toys coming out this year as well, which in turn are certainly Disney toys. So, let's hop over to the special Hasbro showcase, which was actually off-site. It wasn't even at the Javits Center in New York. It was in Times Square at this special location. So, let's move over there again. Invitation only. No other way to get in there except, except through us. So, here it is. An exclusive demonstration of new Star Wars toys coming out this year.
Welcome to Star Wars. Let's first start talking about Angry Birds Star Wars. It's the mashup. It's the greatest mashup of all time, right? It's the mashup of the highest rated game, Angry Birds, with those iconic characters of Star Wars, which is what we have here. We've got Chewbacca and the foam flyer. We've got a collectible action figure that you can not only collect, but also battle. That's the basic gameplay here, just like the digital realm, where we're launching your Angry Birds against the evil pigs. You have a launcher here that you're launching your action figure against the Star Destroyer. And that will be the big game set this year, which is the Star Destroyer battle game set. So that is Angry Birds. As you walk down here, you'll get to see some other stuff, such as the Anakin to Darth Vader action figure. Star Wars is all about, you know, celebrating the rise of Darth Vader this year. And this is a 13-inch electronic action figure with blue lightsaber blade. The best thing about this is he has movie phrases as Anakin, but he also comes with the armor so that you can recreate that moment when Anakin dons the mask for the first time and the helmet comes down just like Revenge of the Sith. It gets on there and we hear Darth Vader breathe to life for the very first time. Now once he's changed into Darth Vader, he's transformed, his blade is red.
It is your destiny.
And you have the classic Vader. He'll be out this fall. $24.99 is the price point on that. And again, like I said, talking about that celebration of the rise of Darth Vader, this is the Anakin to Darth Vader color change lightsaber. Blue blade, just like Anakin, but as I fight the Force, Anakin's fighting the dark side of the Force, he transitions from not only the blue blade, but transitions into Darth Vader and becomes the evil Sith Lord. How do you complete that transformation? Well, you take your Darth Vader electronic helmet that has phrases programmed in, or you can also change your voice. Now I am the Master. And that's our other role-playing item. For our most avid Star Wars fans, down here we have Star Wars The Black Series, which is the first time that we're releasing a 6-inch scale action figure that allows us to have more articulation, better sculpts of the action figure, more detail. I mean, check out the wrinkles within the flight suit of Luke Skywalker there. It's really impressive. There'll be a line of 8 figures coming out this year. It'll be $19.99 as a retail. We'll also have the 3 3/4-inch action figures on the level above you. They'll be coming out in fall as well, and they'll be $9.99. So this is the best that Hasbro has to offer for our most avid of Star Wars fans. And that's Star Wars.
And that's the collaboration with Jack.
some more fun stuff there. I'm a big Star Wars collector as well, so I'll definitely be purchasing that Black Series. It looks really incredible. The detailing on those new 6-inch figures are just wonderful. They were showing off the Luke Skywalker in his orange jumpsuit, and it just looked better than any Star Wars figure I had ever seen that came out of Hasbro. Of course, there have been big statues and that kind of thing, but to be an actual action figure to be in that scale, I'm really excited for that line of figures. Of course, there were many more products from Hasbro and from many other companies that were related to Disney. Again, I've posted a wrap-up over on InsideTheMagic.net. There's an additional video, sort of a tour of products that I'm not going to include here on the show, that's already over on the website for Marvel products, also within the universe of the Hasbro showroom. So head on over to InsideTheMagic.net to see photos, that video, more videos, and sometime this week, probably Monday, Tuesday, I'll be posting a big wrap-up of everything non-Disney, the sort of a best of Toy Fair as well. So for you collectors out there, it's all pretty exciting, and you can get your bank accounts ready.
Hey, Ricky.
Hi, Ricky.
Hi, Ricky.
Hey, Ricky.
Hi, Ricky.
Hi, Ricky.
Hey, Ricky.
Ricky, this is amazing.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls.
Inside the Magic, listener feedback.
Let's do just a little bit of listener feedback this week. I don't want to skip it again, but also we're running a little long on time here, so jumping right into it. An email from Jason, who writes, I have just begun listening to your podcast, and I love it. In a recent podcast, you talked about Frank and Weenie and compare it to The Nightmare Before Christmas. I'm a fan of Burton, and you can't really compare the two because Burton only directed Frank and Weenie. He only produced and wrote Nightmare. It's kind of like comparing Burton's Batman to Schumacher's Batman. While Burton directed the first two, he produced the third. I haven't seen, but plan on seeing Frank and Weenie, and by no means saying it's bad or good, just wanted to point that out. And yes, Jason, you do have an excellent point there, though. I mean, Nightmare Before Christmas really is Burton's baby, whether he directed it or not. So there are some comparisons to be drawn there, as to Corpse Bride as well. I mean, for obvious reasons, the look, the characters, the style, etc., etc., but or even down to the fact that there's always seems to be a main character and a dog in all three of those films. That's almost a progression of characters there. But anyway, yes, Burton did not direct Nightmare Before Christmas. Definitely worth noting there. Eric writes in and says, as you may have been aware, during the 2011 D23 Expo, Disney has plans for bringing back Circle Vision 360. What you might not know is that in recent years, Disney has been actively involved with the Doctor Who franchise, even being responsible for the K-9 spinoff series. As of right now, season 2 is currently being developed, which made me think, since Disney has recently been involved with the Doctor Who franchise, do you think it's possible that K-9, or possibly the Doctor himself, could be used to bring back a show, The Timekeeper, cashing in on recent international increased appeal by the Doctor Who franchise? It would completely fit in with the theme of Tomorrowland, and I could see this being a real possibility. Well, Eric, a lot of you are going to gasp at this, but I've never even seen Doctor Who at all. I know there are massive, huge, die-hard Doctor Who fans out there. Many, many. It's very popular. It's probably something I would enjoy if I got into it. I just never have. So with that said, it's kind of one of those niche things. Yes, it's very, very popular amongst a certain audience, but the general public going to a Disney theme park, I'm not sure if Doctor Who would work out. They'd probably enjoy an attraction based on that, but may not totally get what it is. Just the fact that it's not sort of a U.S. product. It's, from overseas. It's, one of those things. I don't know. I don't know how well. I guess Harry Potter is not technically a U.S. product. The films were shot anyway. He's very popular here. It could work in the right context. Maybe not Tomorrowland, maybe not Timekeeper type of thing, but I do think a Doctor Who attraction would be certainly very, very interesting to be worked in somewhere. Certainly as more and more big movie franchises are getting more attention and more themed environments, I really can't say too much about Doctor Who because, like I said, I haven't seen it, but there's definitely something there that could be integrated, and many people would be very, very happy. Karen writes in and says, I'm a huge Disney fan and a huge fan of your show. Disney has always had a special place in my heart. I actually look forward to Mondays because of your show. I also wish you did multiple podcasts every week because I enjoy your show oh so much. My question is about Spectrum Magic. I know Disneyland's Electrical Parade took over a few years ago, but do you know if Spectrum Magic will ever come back to the Magic Kingdom at Walt Disney World? And do you know where Spectrum Magic is at right now? Karen, well, first, thanks for the praise. Multiple podcasts every week? No, I don't think that's going to happen. I barely have time to put together this one show every week, let alone multiple shows. Years and years ago, I actually did a second podcast briefly for a few months called The Daily Dose of Disney, where I did a daily show. And that didn't, you know, that got old fast for me. I'm sure it was very entertaining. I hope it was very entertaining, but I just ran out of time and couldn't do it anymore. So much as I would love to do that, it's not going to happen, unfortunately. But as far as your question about Spectrum Magic, the parade is here, technically. The floats are, you know, backstage, Magic Kingdom, sitting there waiting for their opportunity to shine once again. There have been many rumors of Spectra returning this year, maybe. Maybe limited time magic, maybe not. Maybe just coming back. I really don't have any firm information. Lots of rumors, to be honest, about it returning sometime this year, but nothing firm at this point. It could certainly happen. The floats essentially are there waiting to come back. So I'd say just, you know, give it some time. I can't imagine Spectra Magic is gone forever. It'll come back at some point. Let's do a couple more emails and wrap this up. Stephanie writes in and says, I watch / listen to your podcast every week. Thanks for all the hard work and the information. Disney Animation yesterday released the animated short Paper Man on YouTube. I loved it the first time I saw it in theaters, preceding Wreck-It Ralph. And, of course, again, rewatching it on the web. And then I noticed it then and again today on YouTube what seems to be a young Carl Fredrickson from Up at 5 minutes and 39 seconds into the short. I'm wondering if I'm the only one who caught him. Stephanie, very interesting. I certainly had to go back, and it's not something that I noticed when I was watching Paper Man to begin with. Of course, Paper Man is not a Pixar short. It is a Disney, you know, feature animation short. I definitely went back to see if there was somebody that resembled a young Carl Fredrickson, and, well, it seems there's a little boy sitting down with a bow tie holding a balloon. Definitely seems like a reference to Up to me. So one of those little extra things to catch in there. Thanks very much for that email. Nate writes in and asks, how come Disney doesn't do the concrete handprints anymore? When was the last time they did it? I think they should do it for the cast of major successful films like The Avengers. Make a good film and you get your reward as a handprint. Nate, thanks for that email. Of course, he's referring to the handprints in front of the Chinese theater at Disney's Hollywood Studios. And sadly, the whole Chinese theater is blocked by that big hat. It's really not an emphasis on that notion of Hollywood there so much anymore. There used to be big events where celebrities would show up to Hollywood Studios. Yes, there were the handprints. There was also, you know, sort of the celebrity of the day kind of thing, parades, etc. None of that really happens anymore, and I agree. It would be fun to have not only, you know, Disney PR puts out a lot of photos of celebrities who are there for on vacation, like, you know, they grab them real quick, take a photo with a character, they go on, do their vacation, Disney gets some publicity out of it, they, you know, get a lot of headlines everywhere for a celebrity visiting there. It certainly would be fun if they could then grab a few of those celebrities, especially when it's tied into, you know, big properties like The Avengers, and have that sort of Hollywood moment of, you know, having the concrete handprints as well. I completely agree. Why doesn't Disney do it? You know, they probably just don't see much interest or the hassle of it, et cetera, et cetera. I don't know. It's just not something that they have a lot of emphasis on. I mean, even if you look at the Great Movie Ride, it hasn't exactly been updated with any, you know, modern films ever. I mean, it's had its little updates here and there, but nothing, you know, major. So I definitely think that could sort of have a revitalization of that whole area. You know, give the Great Movie Ride a little bit of an overhaul, put some even different classic movies, some modern movies in there, change around a few scenes, and then you could certainly promote that, the updated Great Movie, or the Greater Movie Ride, if you will, with those additional celebrity appearances. That would be a lot of fun, in my opinion. Whether that's ever going to happen, I don't know. But it's a good idea. Let's do one more email here. Jason writes in and said, I just finished watching episode 408 and really enjoyed the Star Wars episode 7 discussion with Skipper Ben. To me, one of the most memorable aspects of the Star Wars franchise is the wonderful music from John Williams, but now with J.J. Abrams directing episode 7, I have a feeling that Williams will not be back, as Michael Giacchino is a constant collaborator with Abrams. I do immensely enjoy Giacchino's work, my favorite being The Incredibles, and I thought his arrangements for Star Tours 2 were great, but I don't know if I would replace Williams for such an iconic series. What do you personally think will happen? Should they stay with the tradition and keep John Williams? Jason, it's taken me a few weeks to read your email here, and you probably already know this, but John Williams has just this week expressed interest in returning to the Star Wars series to score it. I have a feeling it's going to be a bit of a collaboration. Yes, I absolutely would be on board for John Williams producing a whole new score for episode 7. A new theme for the new characters would be wonderful, even carrying that into future films. I don't know, you know, if he's on board for the whole thing or maybe just developing those themes and letting Giacchino flesh it out, or perhaps he'll work on the major films, episode 7, 8, and 9, while Giacchino could work on the other sort of spin-off films that we talked about recently. Of course, those don't necessarily have anything to do with J.J. Abrams, so who knows? Personally, since you asked, I could see the two working together, since, as you said, J.J. Abrams does have such a close tie with Giacchino, but John Williams obviously has such a close tie to the Star Wars series. I think it would be an amazing collaboration between the two to come up with sort of a little bits of both of their styles. There's my own personal thought, and that'll do it for listener feedback this week.
There's a great big beautiful tomorrow.
And that's where we're going to wrap up show 412 of Inside the Magic. Hopefully you enjoyed our little trip on over to Antarctica this week for a hard hat construction preview. Definitely a lot of work still to be done there, but there's a few months to go. May 24th. In fact, what is that? That's February, March, April, May. 3 months from now, exactly to the day, is when it's going to be opening. I'm really looking forward to it. They've said they're right on schedule, and it definitely was coming together. I really can't wait to see how the ice is going to sparkle in the day, and then at night, and then of course this trackless ride. Hopefully it will live up to all the hype. You can definitely head over to the website to see more from that, as well as from Toy Fair, which again, hopefully you enjoyed our little tours of upcoming products there as well. I certainly enjoyed looking at all of it, as I am a big collector of not only Disney but many types of toys. Certainly Transformers and Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, and my wife loves My Little Pony and Monster High and so many more things, and all of that you'll be able to see in our non-Disney Toy Fair wrap-up coming this week over on the website as well. So head over there to check that out. I do want to thank Magical Travel for sponsoring this week's episode of Inside the Magic. You can find out more about their services by visiting magicaltravel.com. And also check us out over at lanyardlab.com to see all the different styles and custom lanyard options that we have available. You can request a price quote today to receive a free digital preview of your lanyard design. Of course, there's those capturing magic iPhone apps if you want to organize your photos better when you're capturing those magical moments around Disney's parks at Walt Disney World and Disneyland. Check that out by searching Capturing Magic on the iTunes Store. And of course, between episodes of this show, visit InsideTheMagic.net. It is your source for Disney and theme park news, and lately reaching out to conventions and video games and movies and all that good stuff. Plenty more. Looking forward to the Oscars tonight. I'm sure I'll be posting a little bit of a win-loss thing for Disney once that happens. But always many things going on over there. Podcasts, videos, photos, news, articles, all that good stuff. Follow us on Twitter and Facebook and YouTube. I think I just saw that today we passed 17,000 likes on Facebook. So if you're not liking us, following us, whatever you want to call it on Facebook, go do that and subscribe on YouTube and follow on Twitter, etc., etc. Anyway, thanks to all of you for listening and for watching each and every week. Have a magical week. Bye.
There's a great big beautiful tomorrow, just a dream away.